1,200 miles off the coast of New England, is one of the richest fishing grounds on Earth. The Grand Banks, home to brutal weather and unpredictable seas. This is where the perfect storm exploded. Over the years, thousands of lives have been lost here. Yet every fall, a few brave fishermen risk everything as they sail these deadly waters in search of giants. Three weeks into the season, and some of the fleet are still struggling to find the fish.
The guys need to see a little blood on the deck.
The pressure is taking its toll.
Buddy, you need to get the hell over there to your box.
But even when they found the fish, injuries and accidents drag them back down.
Well, back left.
Yeah, it's 100% off that, dude.
What?
Now, life is on the line as the search for souls continues. Off the Newfoundland coast is the 57-foot Big Eye, under Captain Chris Chompers Hansen. It's 5 a.m. Chompers is first out of his bunk and immediately knows there's something wrong.
As soon as I wake up, I see that, I gotta go check my pumps because I think I'm sinking or something. Dang! We wake up, we're on our rail. We're dealing with 30 knots of wind today. And look at us, 40-degree list.
Without the protection of a steel hull, the little fiberglass Big Eye is no Grand Banks boat. Now she's leaning dangerously to starboard.
As soon as I walked up here, I knew right away that we were listed, because I was scared we were sinking.
We got more than a 1,500-pound list. It's about 3,000.
Yesterday's set brought in over 3,000 pounds of fish, finally covering the Big Eye's expenses. But then the captain's little brother Woody loaded the catch wrong. Now Chompers is on the warpath.
Goes and puts every fish we catch on one side of the boat.
I only do what the captain tells me to do. I don't do anything different. If I do, I'll tell him that I did something tough. But I didn't.
Woody, drop that bird!
The steel birds are dropped to help stabilize the rolling boat. The birds act like wings in the water, creating drag to help keep the boat on an even keel. By dropping one bird, the crew hopes to compensate for the uneven load. But the stabilizers weren't designed for this kind of stress. Until they can redistribute the load, the Big Eye is vulnerable to being capsized by a rogue wave.
How are we listing so much?
We're putting ice over
there. Why are we listing
as hard as we can? They weren't listed last night this bad.
It's listed now.
So that's how a boat sinks. It gets all the weight on it, and then it goes shifts to one side.
To make matters worse, a deep low pressure system is heading straight for the Big Eye. Conditions are ripe for the kind of perfect storm the Grand Banks is famous for.
Now it's gonna blow 30. We're gonna get our beat even worse because we're sitting on her side.
As Woody races to right the boat, the rest of the crew gets ready for the haul back.
I think we got about maybe 20 or 25 knots here hauling back in.
The day begins slowly. Nothing but empty hooks.
We got a 9-foot sea building a 15-foot, and they're so close together, when we come up on one, instead of going back down, we come right off of it.
definitely makes life a little more interesting.
I'm back to waking up now. Another day in paradise.
Twenty miles to the north is the Seahawk. The storm is starting to catch up with Captain Linda Greenlaw and her crew as they start their fifth haul of the season.
The weather report was wrong yesterday. This was supposed to be 5 to 10.
So far, the 80-foot Seahawk has had a disastrous season. Engine failure forced them back to port. Worst of all, poor fishing has put this boat deep in the red. Now, the Grand Banks has whipped up the first major storm of the season.
Today was supposed to be a nice day.
Sometimes it don't go according to plan.
So far, 100 empty hooks. The fishing is as bad as the weather. And Linda desperately needs a big day to get her season back on track.
Considering the weather, I've seen a couple of snarls come up empty, so I think, you know, we've bounced a couple off here and there.
The socks. The leather socks.
Dave Hiltz is a veteran lobster fisherman and a good friend of Linda's, but he's finding his first sword fishing trip on the Grand Banks hard to handle.
Don't know a thing. They get up in the morning, they guess at what it's going to be, and then they're never close.
The wind is blowing at 45 knots, but with 20 miles of gear still in the water, Linda has no choice but to keep fishing. As the storm intensifies, the fish start to bite.
Can't even keep things under control out here.
Live sword.
Two hooks later, another big sword. It's at least 200 pounds and worth over a grand.
Woo-hoo!
When they put a steak on their grill, a sword steak in particular, these are the kind of conditions that a normal human being will do to get it for them. When they hum and moan that it costs 14 bucks, maybe they'll understand.
The crew of the Seahawk has finally hit pay dirt, but to collect, they must face the fury of the Grand Banks head on. It's going to push them to their limits. 70 miles to the north, the Eagle Eye 2 pounds its way through heavy seas, stirred up by a classic fall storm. The Grand Banks is reminding veteran Captain Scotty Drabinowitz just who's in charge.
Seas just kind of keep on building. I'd certainly rather be somewhere else than here right now.
Scotty is playing catch up after losing vital fishing days taking an injured deckhand to shore.
That's it, trip's over.
Last night, he took careful water temperature measurements. Now he hopes he's on the fish.
Swordfish.
Swordfish!
I got it. Nice one.
Come on, man. Guys, on your own. Get your gaff out, drag him across.
I don't like him near the door.
Nice fish right there.
The 90-foot Eagle Eye 2 is showing why it's one of the top boats in the fleet.
Oh, yeah!
Got it?
Yeah.
Woo! Nice marker.
The swell is now over 20 feet. A violently rolling deck mixed with fish oil and water makes for a lethal combination. The lost sword sinks 2 miles into the depths. Deckhand Tommy Fox is dead lucky not to have joined it.
Trying to save the fish, yeah. But it kept going.
We got hit by a big wave, washed the fish overboard, almost Fox as well.
Weather like this, people can get hurt or even die.
It's getting rough, even for this experienced crew. Scotty's not taking any chances with marine biologist Lisa Natanson.
There's no reason for her to endanger her life to put a couple tags in. Quite frankly, I won't allow it.
Scotty has allowed Lisa on the boat this trip to tag sharks, but today she's shut down.
Well, after that wave hit, and I was right there, and Scotty's like, you're done. So I'm like, okay.
I hope she's inside baking us cookies.
300 miles off the Newfoundland coast, Captain Chompers and the rest of the Big Eye crew are hauling into a big swell and 50-knot winds.
The weather's deteriorating rather quickly. Seems like more water's going over top of us than underneath us.
Earlier, the Big Eye was listing dangerously on its side. But hard work from Woody in the hold righted the boat. It's now an intense battle for the crew as the little Big Eye rolls violently into the 20-foot swell.
This kind of weather, oh yes. People will see how hard it is to be in the glad bags, to make a paycheck to pay your bills. No time to think about your girlfriend or your wife. You got to think about yourself right now out here.
Got a fish.
30 minutes into the haul, the first bite.
Yes, really hold that fish now.
Hey, no, come on! Okay.
Woo!
Marker!
Minutes later, another sword.
Okay.
Up!
That's a 200 pounds.
Suddenly, it seems every hook has a fish on it. The bigger the weather gets, the bigger the fish get.
Got him!
Yeah.
God bless Big Eye!
Fish is pretty good. We're doing pretty well. We got as much in less than half our gear than we had in all our gear yesterday.
As they pull the last beeper, the Big Eye crew know they've survived a day from hell.
In all, we had 42 fish. I think we had about 22 markers, 4,000 pound of fish, close to 5,000 pound of fish.
From the first section this morning, it was just fish after fish after fish. This is why I came up here, to see fishing like this.
Today we got our butts kicked on the Grand Banks. Say at least like 6 or 7 fish that are 200 pounds. Banner day on the Grand Banks for the Big Eye.
Chompers' Grand Banks gamble has paid off. The skipper has a swagger to his step.
Anybody can haul 4,000 pounds of fish on the boat in a gale of wind, boat that many big fish, somebody would seriously have a problem to say anything bad towards me.
30 miles to the north, even the luckless Seahawk is having a big day. Captain Linda Greenlaw is back in her element.
Swordfish! Nice one.
This 150-pounder is the 20th fish of the day.
Watch that, Bill.
No!
Good job. It's been steady. I mean, I know it's been the best day we've had, so that's good.
Green hook's hanging right there, Mike.
Another one.
What's your work cut out for you there, Mikey? You guys are trying to kill me one fish at a time, I can tell.
No, 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 no!
Woo-hoo!
Nice!
Nice fish, people!
Mike cleans and guts the fish, but can barely keep pace as the deck starts to fill up. In this heaving swell, it's an accident waiting to happen. Deck, Mike nearly slides out the door.
Chicks now.
It ended okay. It could have been very, very bad.
Linda is lucky to have lost only a fish.
I did suggest that door go in first thing this morning, and I was told that it was too hard to get in and out, so I think it's in now.
Battered and bruised, Mike heads to the hold to pack the fish, but soon finds it's no safer below deck. The Seahawk crew are catching fish, but at what cost? As another fish appears on the line, the storm strikes back. Tim loses his gaff hook to the sea. Without it, he can't pull fish on board.
Go get the grapple.
Tim and Dave try to retrieve it. But Dave's wild lunge hits something else.
Ah! You all right?
Yeah. Okay.
What'd you do, hook your hand?
Tim, you all right, man? Gonna go in there?
Tim's hand has been impaled.
How bad?
Bad.
Did it go through?
Yeah. Through your whole hand?
No, not through the whole hand.
It hit hard. I mean, like I said, I guess it hurts more because it hit a bone, but that was fortunate because it stopped it from going right through the hand.
With 10 miles of main line still in the water, Tim has to make running repairs and get back on deck. There's fish on the line, and each fish gets bigger and bigger. Swordfish on the Grand Banks have been known to top half a ton.
That's a big fish.
This monster is at least 300 pounds.
He's... Yeah.
Oh, whoa, tranquility base. The eagle has landed.
Live sword. Fish on, Dave.
After days of bad fishing, the Seahawk is finally on the fish. The conditions are forgotten. The guys are making money.
Got it?
Despite their wounds, the Seahawk has brought in nearly 3,000 pounds of fish. It's the best day of the trip so far. After a brutal 10-hour haul, the Seahawk pulls the last beeper.
Another long day aboard the Seahawk.
My crew pretty much took a beating today. Everybody got hurt.
But a good day. By far our best day.
Nice job. Good job, baby. Tough day, man.
Miles from New England, the Francis Ann under Captain Chris Clem is coming to the end of a successful trip.
Fishing was great. We had 33 swords and tunas.
The trip was put in jeopardy when greenhorn Ben Ramo got hurt.
What? My wrist just popped out. Pull back in, please.
For the last 5 days, Ben has been taking it easy while the rest of the crew hustle to cover for him. Now it's the last haul of the trip, and Chris thinks it's time for Ben to lend a hand.
Why don't you see if you can help these guys out, build a dob here or there. I'm not asking you to pull on the hooks or pull fish. Just maybe you can crank in a dob here or there for them guys.
If it hurts, I'll just stop, so
whatever, we'll see how it goes.
Last night, Chris set out 30 miles of line. Ben's job is low impact. Wind the buoy lines onto the wheel.
Heads up, heads up, heads up.
I got it, thank you.
Not long before Ben walks off the deck.
That's it? That's all we got out of him today? I guess Ben's done.
I just don't want to get like really swollen again and just set myself back farther.
Nice shot.
Back to being a man down, Chris, Lemmy, and Brian finish the final day's haul.
Like a 50-pounder or something, Brian.
A nice 50-pound tuna, which brings the trip total to 9 tons.
Hook's out.
Chris turns the Francis Ann round and heads for home, but the greenhorn is still bugging him.
He showed more laziness than interest on the boat. A person that doesn't participate and at least just give a little bit of an effort, that makes everything more difficult. Unless you told him to do something, he wouldn't do anything. Whether or not he knew he had to do it.
Miles to the northeast is the Big Eye. The storm has blown out, and the Big Eye enjoys a rare moment of calm.
Miles of gear left. If we could get another 10 fish, we would be good. Bring us a very low market value.
With a fast filling hold, it should be all sunshine and smiles on the Big Eye. But a tangled line sets off chompers.
Now take that tangle and boot it.
As usual, little brother Woody is the target.
Woody, look at me. Look at me. Yeah. Get that line off the deck.
I'm actually harder on my brother than I would be an actual crew member. I expect a lot out of him. I want him to be good at what he does, and the only way to do that is to push him as hard as I can. And that, unfortunately, that's by not being nice.
Let the line go overboard. No, pull it, but let it go over. It was going on the boat. I don't want it by your damn feet.
It takes an hour to free the line, and then they find out why it's tangled. A 500-pound monster swordfish.
Woo! How big is it?
Too damn big.
Well, you don't stand in it.
Got him, let him go. Like that. Somebody hold that leader. Well, the fish is floating anyway.
Chompers needs every man and his winch to bring up this Goliath fish. Miles from Newfoundland, the Big Eye under Captain Chompers has hooked a quarter-ton monster. Now they have to get it on the boat.
Wait till you gotta try to get him in the hole.
Oh,
Right? 500 pounds, my guess.
It's one thing to land a 500-pound fish on deck. It's another to find a place to put it.
We're gonna get this fish down somehow. Matt's got that. All right, Weeks, come on.
In good condition, this fish could be worth $3,000.
You got enough room to let that down? Lift up on this fish. Weeks has got it. Watch out, Woody. You ain't doing nothing. Weeks has got it. Get the hook out of it like I told you. Take the hook out. Thank you. I mean, what the f*** you gonna do with that hook, Woody? Now go down there and help him if you want to use it.
It ain't gonna take me too much longer before he's gonna do stuff like that, and I'm not just gonna keep on taking it. I'm just gonna leave. My man can only take so much, you know?
Watch
this. He treats y'all like kings and queens, and he's gonna treat me like just because I'm related to him, but that don't work like that. It's not supposed to, you know?
I think Woody's a little pissed. Hey, Woody's really pissed.
Right now, he's a little bit miserable. He even just cussed his own brother, so I guess when he has frustration in him, he takes it out on his brother.
I've worked with him for 8 years, you know, and he's my brother, and I love him, but he gets to be a lot.
I'll continue to be hard with him until he's as good or better than I am.
You know, I can find something else for me to do or something. You know, I got things I can do too, you know.
Seventy miles to the north, the Eagle Eye 2 has overcome a slow start on their 10th haul. Now, they're right on the fish.
Let's go!
We've been right in this water, and all of a sudden, boom, here they are.
Swordfish!
You gotta be quick, man. You know, real quick.
Double header! Slamming them today.
Two nice fish.
70.
Yeah.
Since the storm rolled in, the Eagle Eye 2 has pulled in 15,000 pounds of fish. Each day, they're adding to that total. This is a fishing machine.
Hey, he's coming. You see him?
Where's he at?
Nice spot. Watch your hands. Hold on.
Yeah, baby. Woo. That's nice fish.
Oh, beauty, man. Beauty. Dandy.
It's 400 pounds at least and could be worth $2,500.
Yeah, that's definitely a Grand Banks fish there. That's what we come for.
1,200 miles from New England, the Seahawks' recent run of good fishing has come to a full stop.
It's gonna be a mess.
After hauling all morning with no fish, Captain Linda Greenlaw discovers her main line has been going into the drum wrong.
Level line got f***ed up.
That sucks.
Kind of pisses me off because I've asked every 15 minutes how the drum looks. Everything's great. I can't see it from here. Oh, well, but I'm pissed right now.
As the line is hauled in, it should be distributed evenly across the drum. Instead, it's all gone down one side.
The line's not all the way over there, but we're pretty close.
The line is inside the drum, it's not the drum.
Pull the bird up. Can't take a chance on it again.
Linda has no choice but to stop hauling, reverse the drum, and let the main line out again. Otherwise, she's going to have 30 miles of knots.
How's that looking?
Another mile.
Poor equipment. You can't be in the fishing business and fish with gear.
All right, tell
them
to go.
Not commonplace, but they pop off, you know?
After a two-hour delay, the crew gets back to fishing. But the line brings up empty hook after empty hook.
Fishing socks. Time to go south.
The Seahawk just can't shake the black cloud that's hanging over them.
Struggling against the force of danger.
This isn't what lobsterman Dave Hilt signed up for.
Trip is straight from the depths of PG double hockey sticks.
It's almost like being in a POW camp. You know, we've dealt with such adversity.
It sucks. Every day it's something new. All we ask for now is one day without something friggin' up. I'm resigning right now. Watch. Done, that's it.
This is the longest he's ever been at sea. It looks like Dave's first trip to the Grand Banks is going to end early.
Dave? Oh yeah, he's fragile. Easily cracked.
It's hard for everyone when one guy doesn't work out. They stay up and they complain and whine and tell you how much everything sucks every minute. Like, what, we don't know? Like, why did you come? What did you think you were getting into? Do you think you're going to SeaWorld?
It sucked. This trip sucked. There's no getting around it.
Think about it. Quick, where are you going to go here? Are you going to walk off your job right into the ocean?
Miles off the Jersey Shore is the Frances Ann.
He's all set and down in the dumps right now, but as soon as we hit that dock, he's gonna act like he was never even on this boat. You watch.
The lighthouse marks the entrance to their home port of Barnegat Light. It's a welcome sight for the tired crew. Ben has been moving slow all week, but as soon as they hit the dock, he's quick to get off. It's a good catch, but right now the price for swords is low, just over $2 per pound.
Swordfish market's pretty low right now. A lot of the Banks boats came in with a lot of fish. Good price, bad price, so gotta keep fishing.
With their catch heading off to East Coast sushi bars and restaurants, the crew finds out what they will make.
Normally on a trip like that, the guys are hoping to make $5,000-$7,000 for the trip.
Really, I worked for 9 days. I made $6,000. I mean, it's pretty good money.
Meanwhile, on the other side of town, Ben's injury has improved enough for him to catch a few waves.
My fishing days are not over yet. It was a rough first trip, but I mean, I think everyone's first trip's usually pretty rough. Not just a job you hop into and you know what you're doing right away. You got to sort of get broken in.
I don't want him back on the boat.
The thing that pissed me off the most is 20 minutes after we tied the boat up, he's on the beach surfing, paddling around like nothing. So it's not right. I don't have anything good to say about him. I'm sure he's a nice kid, but the least he could have done was pick up a little bit of your weight and help the guys out, but he didn't. He totally bailed on us. Totally milked it for everything it was worth.
The Francis Ann will head out in 2 days, and Chris is a man down. Now he must find a new deckhand and hope he doesn't get burned again. 300 miles off the Newfoundland coast is the little southern boat, Big Eye. Captain Chompers is halfway through his eighth haulback, and it's not looking good. His main line has drifted into colder waters, and cold water usually means one thing, sharks.
A doggy day on the Big Eye. We're up to 80 plus blue dogs, I believe 14 swordfish.
Blue sharks, or blue dogs, have no value at market and actually cost the boat in gear. Rather than risk a deadly bite, the crew cut the line and the sharks swim off with a hook, designed to rust away in a few months. It's put Chompers in a dark mood, and that usually means trouble for his little brother, Woody.
Take the hook out. Look at me. Woody, you need to get the hell over there to your box.
I'm hard on Woody. You know, I push him. If I'd slack back on Woody at any time, he wouldn't be like the way he is. He wouldn't be.
By midday, the far more aggressive Mako sharks start hitting the line. They can be sold, but getting these deadly fish on board is a risky venture.
Those shark are real dangerous. Dangerous species.
We got him. There's nobody panic here.
Just watch out. Yeah, watch out. Let me get nice.
Kill that fish.
As the Big Eye steams through the shark-infested waters, Woody is playing it safe. Any mistake could send his brother into another rage. But then he drops a $10 buoy.
Oh, get a buoy, Woody.
Okay. You got it, Woody? Careful,
Woody.
I couldn't see. I didn't know which way the boat was going. I'm upside down.
I'd be in big trouble. My mom would freak. I'd never hear it in, though. I'd probably get away with it if I did it my other brother. But yep, he's the baby. He's the baby.
30 miles to the north, the Seahawk is having a sparse haulback. Captain Linda Greenlaw has lost the fish. With the hold only half full, Linda desperately needs her luck to change.
We're hauling perfectly on the break. There are no fish here.
To make matters worse, her crew is unraveling before her eyes.
Almost like being in a POW camp.
And then Dave quits.
I'm done, that's it.
Now, Linda has to do what she can to keep the rest of her crew intact.
We've all had crew members who have hit the bunk. Just most of the time, it's just they just can't do the work. They just can't take it.
As far as Linda is concerned, no one goes home until they catch more fish.
Sometimes they hit the rack for a day or two and then realize that the boat's still out fishing and they're not doing anything, so they come out of it. Other times they stay in the rack.
At the end of the day's haul, Linda finds a message waiting for her in the wheelhouse.
Scotty called me on the sat phone and said, message from Jim Buddy. You will be in on the 18th, no ifs, ands, or buts.
The price of swordfish has risen overnight, and the Seahawks owner wants them to head 300 miles to Newfoundland to unload. Their first trip is over.
It's not a decision I'm happy about, but I don't own the boat, and I, you know, will accommodate the owner's wishes, and that is make our last set and go in.
But will there be anything left of her crew when she comes back out?